Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gents. May I request for your attention? Just hold on. Can I request that nobody else moves now? Our academic procession is going to come in. Can I respectfully request also that when the procession song starts and when the academic procession comes in, that we all stand and remain standing until the song is finished and they are told to sit down. Thank you very much.
Okay. Just give me a thumbs up. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. You may all be seated. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. By way of introduction, my name is Thabo Godfrey Mongatani. I am the chairperson of the National Leadership Committee of the ABASA. It is such a great honor to be hosting everybody here. Thank you so much for making the time and joining us online. Welcome to the 2022 version of the Prof. Wiseman Nkuhlu lecture. Without any waste of time, I've already been told that we live on borrowed time, especially with ESCOM, so 4 o'clock we really need to be done. I will now start by welcoming the HOD of the Nkuhlu Department of Education to do the formal welcome, and then we can get everything started. Thank you so much. Prof, over to you. How? Some hand clap, Nyana. Thank you so much.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for coming to this lecture that we are holding. We're very proudly associated with Professor Nkuhlu. We're really glad. I had my privilege of meeting him this afternoon, and I think we will get an opportunity all to see him. It is really an honor for us, and an honor indeed to hold this lecture. I was just speaking to the president of ABASA and asking her where else they have held this lecture. And I think we are the second academic institution in the whole country. So it is a huge honor for us to be here this afternoon. And I'm not going to go through any protocols. I think that's not within what I've been asked to do this afternoon. I just want to officially welcome everyone to this lecture and to open and welcome the Vice Chancellor of the University of Fort Hare, Professor Sekela Butlungu, to come and welcome everyone to this lecture officially. Thank you, Prof. Would you?
Thank you very much, Professor Smatele. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, everyone. That's better. I'm doing this for Professor Nkuhlu. You can't. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, Professor Nkuhlu. Thank you very much for this. I was very thrilled that everyone made it to this lecture. The room is full, and I think the interest is tremendous to come in and listen to the guest speaker, but also to once again to honor a Thortonian and a professor and many, many, many other things, a trailblazer, Professor Nkuhlu. But I thought that because Professor Smartele has actually welcomed everybody, you've done. So I thought all I'll do here is sit or stand and name drop. And name drop. And please take the name dropping as a way of welcoming you and making you feel comfortable and at ease. But first, we are among friends here, among friends. The first friend of the university is Professor Nkuhlu himself, who has carried the flag over many decades. I'll say more about that. But I also want to acknowledge the president of ABASA, Ms. Linda Makoma. Right. I also want to welcome the CEO of SAICA, Mr. Freeman Nomvalo. Yep. From KPMG, I want to welcome the CEO, Mr. Ignatius Sihule. The Deputy Auditor General, Ms. Fonani Chauke. As I said, there are many other distinguished colleagues here, but I would like to also acknowledge internally the Deputy Vice Chancellor for Teaching and Learning, Professor Renuka Vital. I would like to welcome or acknowledge the Acting Dean of Faculty, Professor Lizel Silia. And of course, the Head of Accounting, Professor Smartele. Thank you very much. But there's another former Head of Accounting, Mr. Zaguza, it has taken many people over time to build this Nkuhlu Department of Accounting. And Mr. Zaguza is one of those. And we've never met like this, but his name, whenever I'm in accounting, his name comes up. Thank you very much. And the more recent head of accounting also, Wendy. Sorry, Wendy, my mind locked for a second. You can imagine. Thank you very much once again. And now, that's all I have to do, to welcome you and feel free, enjoy the lecture. It's going to, as usual, this is the fifth one, stimulating, challenging, and we need to be challenged. As a university community, as a community of scholars, as a country, as a province, we need to be challenged. There are too many things out there, too many things happening. We need to think. We need thinking. But enough of that. The name dropping is this. Professor Nkuhlu finished his qualification in accounting in 1971. And then he came back for grad in 1972. That's how many years now? 50 years ago. That's 50 years ago. And he then taught accounting at Fort Hare. I'm giving a very abridged kind of name drop here. he then taught and became head of accounting, and then he was one of those who were then deployed to set up the new University of Transkei. And his mandate was to set up the Department of Accounting from scratch, from dust. Okay, talk about legacies. Talk about contribution and legacies. I'm doing this deliberately because this Professor Nkuhlu belongs to that generation before us. And if we drop the ball, it will be on us. It will be on us. Then Professor Nkuhlu then became professor of accounting at UNITRA. Now here's the point, here's the name-dropping part. Our paths crossed, unbeknown to him, but I knew him as a professor in the university, because I joined the University of Transkei as a student in 1980. Now you can count my age, you can work it out. I joined the university in 1980, and he was there. I finished my degree in 1982. I went away to work. He was there, and then he resigned as a professor in 1984 to go into his partnership, for reasons I'm not going to get into. 1984, I returned to that university, so we didn't really cross. Of course, we did things at UNITRA, which is a story for another year, another day. The university was shut down, and sadly, some of us were not allowed to go back. That's another story. So Professor Nkuhlu was then brought in, brought back in as Vice Chancellor of UNITRA in September 1984. So I'm saying all of this because then Professor Nkuhlu's paths and mine crossed again at the University of Pretoria when he was chancellor there. And I was, you know, just one of the people there. And here again, our paths cross again. And once again, I just wanted to once again pay tribute to Prof. Nkuhlu. We've done it before. He has an honorary doctorate from Fort Hare. But we can't do it enough, Prof. Nkuhlu. Please bear with us every time. Please bear with us every time. But also then, finally, I want to just acknowledge the speaker for this afternoon, Mr. Skese, and wish you all the best in presenting this very challenging, I know, very challenging lecture. Thank you very much. Let's give all of us a round of applause to the speaker.
Wow, thank you so much, Prof. Nkuhlu. I think Prof deserves another hand of applause for that for that very rich history. So as I stand before you, I am a product of the Tutuka Upliftment Education Upliftment Fund, and I'm a chartered accountant here today because of the work that ABASA has done, and the work that ABASA has done has been influenced by the courage of the very first black chartered accountant who we are honoring today, who has passed on. I think there's a song. I love music a lot, so please pardon me. You're going to hear a lot of lyrics throughout this. There's a song that says, "Kwangena thina mavulandlela," and this is the original mavulandlela of the chartered accountancy profession. I think, Prof, let's give Prof a big hand. Now, I say this because of the courage that Prof had, and you could imagine, you know, how tough it was back in those days. Just that, you know, selfish decision to say, "I will do this, no matter what the circumstances," has created a great legacy where a lot of us have broken generational curses in our families, where we are the first chartered accountant. He is the first chartered accountant in South Africa, black. And all of us here, and a lot of the people in this room, are the first chartered accountant either in their province, in their community, the municipal district, local municipality, in their school. And if all else fails, if you're not the first chartered accountant in your school, you're probably the first chartered accountant in your street. And Prof, you know, a lot of families have broken generational, curses, like I said, you know, especially the economic one, because now a lot of us are able to now feed our families and the families of the people who work with us within our different firms as we grow. So, Prof, for that, I think you deserve a lot more than this and a lot of rest. Someone said, we call Prof in, he's the fixer. We call Prof in when we want him, when we want something to be fixed. So therefore, ladies and gentlemen, I think it's quite important that we also recognize that the trajectory of the chartered accountancy has just gone up higher and higher within the country, but also we've got a lot of black chartered accountants that are making waves across the world. And that is the courage that it takes to actually change the course of history. And I challenge everybody in this room to also think about that. Now, having said all of that, and be inspired by that, and also have the courage to face whatever it is that you are facing. You may be in public sector or private sector, or wherever you are working in academia, whatever challenges we're facing, let us remember that we are here to try and influence the world. And with that said, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to welcome one of our partners, SAPRO, who enables a lot of the black chartered accountants to play on a global scale. As the official sponsor of the Prof. Wiseman Nkuhlu lecture, I'd like to welcome to the stage SAPRO. Let's give them a big round of applause.
It's always the gentlemen that come up here with no piece of paper that say they're going to speak for 5 minutes and all of a sudden they're orating to the whole crowd. Thank you so much for the warm welcome. Good afternoon, folks. My name is Vincent Dramatima. My colleague is going to introduce himself to you in a couple of minutes. Today we have the privilege, as young professionals in accounting, to represent SAPRO as a headline sponsor of this most memorable event. Often I've always found that when addressing things like this, it's always kind of difficult and challenging for me to kind of personalize with the person that I'm actually speaking about today. But in fear of having delusions of grandeur, I feel with Professor Nkuhlu, I feel that it's quite a simple thing, because I think he not just embodies what I think I hold dear to myself as a micro and one life, I think he embodies what we hold so dear to us as a macro. So we would like to take this time to thank Professor Wiseman for forging the way for black chartered accountants in this country, or rather, let me rephrase, for black chartered accountants globally on hold. Whilst the inclusion of black chartered accountants has been a major issue and highlighted across the nation, and one that SAPRO strives to correct through wonderful organizations such as ABASA, it is evident that the diversity and inclusion is not an issue that will only be isolated to South Africa, but an issue that extends across the boards and appears in many, many forms, and in many ways, what people would go and refer to as a global tune. It was Professor Mutlungu right now who actually said something very profound, and I think it really, really echoes to me, and he says that if we drop the ball, then it's actually all on us. And what I like to believe is that even though the baton isn't firmly in our hands, and I still believe that Professor Wiseman Nkuhlu still has way to go, I do believe that our hands remain very eager and very, very ready. The example that you set is not limited to the boundaries of our nation, but an example to the world to not just observe, but also to analyze, to look forward to, and also trying to instill in not just the facets of inclusivity, but also all facets a whole. It is our job, correction, responsibility, I feel, as young professionals who now interact across the globe to spread the word of your great work, for giving your time to nurture the generations that have followed, and for investing your heart in programs that continue to be benefit of so many accountants. You ran, I believe, so that we can walk. And in many ways possible, I'd like to believe that we will carry on your good work. Beyond this, we also thank you for demonstrating that as accountants, we have the capability to play an active role in the development of human capacity through the advancement of all social economic activity in the country. Because as always, we too can have an impact. Marco?
I always find it very difficult to follow up to Vince. He sets the bar very high. Hi everyone, my name is Marcus Swanepoel. As a young professional at SAPRO, we are supported by an organization that is dedicated to the upliftment, development, and transformation of the accounting profession for the betterment of all. We are encouraged to grow our talents and superpowers so that we can express and realize our greatness and make an impact on the world. We live in sensitive times. Around every corner lurks something negative, something that sows division, whether it's between friends, family, or work colleagues. It's always there, and that is where SAPRO comes in. SAPRO has found a way to turn that division into unity, and we see it every day with the people we are privileged to work with, people from our copious backgrounds. Slowly but surely, SAPRO is casting a light on those dark corners, forcing the negative aspects that plague our society to be reparated. And ladies and gentlemen, we can only do that in one way, and that's together. That being said, before Vince and I overstay our welcome up here and end up in the president's office, we would like to thank ABASA and Linda McCormack, the president of ABASA, for giving SAPRO the opportunity to work and support an organization which does such impactful, consequential, and purposeful work every day. Post the lecture, the SAPRO team will be stationed at the SAPRO photo wall, so come on by, let's have a chat and see how we can uplift our communities together. We look forward to today's lecture and hearing the valuable insights that Professor Wiseman has to share with us. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, one more time for SAPRO. You know, the first time I saw the SAPRO, I wasn't sure if it was SA Pro or SAPRO. And you know when you incorporate, you wait for people to say it, and then you're like, oh. So thank you so much, SAPRO. Ladies and gentlemen, honoring the first chartered accountant, it would be very appropriate that we have the CEO of the South African Institute of Chartered Accountants to give us a message. Mr. Freeman Nomvalo, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Program Director. I think I have to apologize upfront. As a young man, I had ambitions of being a politician. So the time allocated may be too small. And ESCOM may interfere. But Vice Chancellor, the Chancellor of the University of Fort Hare and the DVC, you, University of Fort Hare's leadership, the leadership of the Nkuhlu Department of Accounting, ABASA President, the past presidents of ABASA, the Deputy Auditor General, the CEO of KPMG, who's here, our guest speaker, and of course, Prof. Nkuhlu and Sis Hazel. All the dignitaries that are in this room, I recognize you. The Spanish writer Antonio Machado said, "Traveler, there is no path. The path is made by walking." This motto also is captured in the motto of the Department of School of Accounting, that transforming the landscape of accounting landscape of our continent through inspired teaching and empowered learners. And we know now Professor Nkuhlu was part of that journey. Prof, you have carved the way for many. You have done the heavy lifting, and today the journey is much easier for us, even though it's still challenging. You've done so with dedication, inspiration, dignity, humility, and honor. One may ask, what claim do I have to make these bold statements about Prof? My path has crossed that of Prof several times because his was already there. And in all of that, whenever this privilege fell my way, I have been left amazed at how Prof. Nkuhlu carries his accolades lightly. His humility and his willingness to engage with the mere mortals like myself and still not leave me feeling like I'm less than is one of the most humbling experiences I've had in my field, in my political circles, and so on. Prof is a great man, one of the greatest in our country, and I hope that when the history of this country is written, his name will be among the greatest. But when you meet Prof, as I often have, you get invariably struck by his humility and focus to what needs to be done. It was Ralph Waldo Emerson who posited, and I quote, "The purpose of life is not to be happy, it is to be useful, to be honorable, to be compassionate, to have it make a difference that you have lived and lived well," unquote. Prof embodies this description. He is indeed the testimony of what really matters in life. Most people would like you to know that they were the first this or that, black this or that. Many people would like you to know that they were in the presidential economic advisory team of the president and had the president on speed dial. Many people would want you to know that when there was a crisis in one of the big firms, they were asked to come and chair that and lead the change that would transform the profession and bring it back into its glory. He is an author, he is a leader, a pathfinder. But he does not work he does his work quietly and effectively. He lets his deeds speak for themselves. And that's why today you are having this lecture, amongst other things. I could go on and make an hour's speech, but Victor is here for that role today. I stand at the invitation of ABASA as organizers to say a few words, and I want to say to Prof, thank you for opening the doors through which 8,143 Africans, 2,175 coloreds, 6,406 Indian chartered accountants have gone through. Thank you for carving that path through our racialized history. Prof is the one who understood the words of that Spanish writer, Antonio Machado, "Traveler, there is no path. The path is made by walking." I have no doubt that it was a daunting task, but you held your resolve, weathered the storms, surmounted obstacles that were placed in your path. Because you dared to walk, today we celebrate hundreds of those who qualify each year as chartered accountants. Because you have walked, today all the big four firms are led by black CEOs. Because you have walked, today there are big firms, big black firms. Because you have walked, today we have JSE-listed companies led by black people. Today we can see the transformation in the horizon, and we are more than certain that we will one day reach it. We can see far because we are standing on the shoulders of a giant. Thank you, Prof.
Shoo. Ladies and gentlemen, one more time for the CEO of SAICA. Prof, I just want to tell you when he said we are standing on the shoulders of a giant, I was thinking I'm 112 kgs, so I hope you can take that. Thank you so much, Tate Nomvalo. I read his speech before he came here, and I said, no, this is not going to be 5 minutes. But thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, before I welcome the president of ABASA onto the stage, I would like the choir to just give us something. You've got something?
please, ladies and gentlemen, the University of Fort Hare Choir. Come on now, come on! They deserve better than that. In my home language, Kaspedi Bare, Owa Saring Shate Uwa Duma. Loosely translated, it means, hey. Yeah, I know. Yeah, no. Yeah, no, Spedia's Tolukiwi. Thank you so much, choir. I think they deserve another hand. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my honor to introduce my boss. When the phone rings and you see leadership, when you see Linda there, and you know the first thing she's going to say is, leadership! Where are you? We need to move. You know, truly someone who delivers and cares about delivery. As you can see, it's a packed house today. And I think all the sponsors know, all the CEOs know that if you get a call from Linda, there needs to be some action that needs to be taken. A true inspiration, a true, you know, leader, woman leader. Ulinda is quite young. When you look at the history of ABASA, you know, Ulinda is very young, but it's that wisdom that comes through and her ideas in terms of implementation. And I first want to thank the Eastern Cape for making sure that her vision comes to light. Prof, we've got a sold-out accounting professional excellence dinner tonight, and it's because of my boss and the work that, you know, the ABASA team has been doing under her leadership. Ulinda will deliver a message, and then will be followed by our keynote speaker. Thank you, Ms. Linda. Can you please welcome There's no bonuses at ABASA, but imagine there were.
Yeah, he makes it sound like we get paid at ABASA. Thank you, leadership. I think this item, Prof, speaks to exactly why I did this and why ABASA has done this. Siyabulela. You know, and the choir didn't know what they were going to sing, but as I listened to the words, I'm like, how apt that siyabulela before I even start and say anything. So yes, I do call some of these stakeholders here and I say, I'm moving. And they're like, where? So I must observe protocol here and recognize some people in the room. So Prof, you'll also let me name drop, ne? Yeah, let me do some name dropping. So in the room, Dada, he doesn't like to be called CEO, Freeman Nomvalo, the CEO of SAICA. Your words speak to what ABASA is doing here. Thank you for capturing what Prof is to us. We've got the chair and president of SAIPA here. So ABASA is inclusive, not only CAs, but we've got professional accountants represented here with their chairperson here. Porsha Mkabela from ACCA, they're also going to be here today. Is she here yet? She's here. So that's another accounting body that is here and supporting Prof. I also want to recognize the CEO of KPMG, my former boss. He's still mad at me for leaving, but we are here now, we are fine, we're supporting Prof. To the CEO of SNG, who's going to be delivering an amazing lecture, and my past president, Mr. Victor Sekese, and watching online, Uthando Sawufubu, who's the group executive of Barloworld, who will be speaking later on tonight at the sold-out event that was just mentioned. We've also got the CFO of Facet that's somewhere here representing the CEO of Facet. I'm naming these people because these are the people that made sure that this happened. And I want to then particularly mention our headline sponsor that is represented here, SAPRO. And this is what ABASA is doing, to get everybody together because we all want the same thing. The one thing that Uyanda Mafuleka, the CEO of Facet, said to me when I told her about this lecture, she said, Prof belongs to all of us. And that's why they wanted to support this. And I think we must have that goal in mind when we look at the initiatives that ABASA does. We're not competing. One of my past presidents, Moses Kasana, says there's no competition in transformation. We all want the same thing. So to see you all in this room is absolutely amazing. But I think there's one stakeholder that was not recognized in all of these addresses, the students that are here. I think as an alumni and someone who has sat in this very hall to write exams, to be where I am today, it's important to realize why we're here. Even though we're recognizing this amazing icon and legend in our profession and in our country, we're really doing it for the people that are going to walk out of these doors and make a difference. So to the students that are here, I hope as you listen and you look at the room and everybody that is here for this, please be inspired. And know that the country needs you to do the right thing. So I hope that you will enjoy this lecture. Prof. Mamungul. I engage with them so much in the background. And the most profound thing, and I'm going to say this because it is Women's Month, that Prof, in all that we recognize, there's a strong woman that is supporting you. So. Mamungohlu, I know that Prof will find it absolutely adequate that we also thank you for giving us this amazing individual in our community, in our profession, and in our country. Thank you. VC, my co-host, thank you. Because when I sent the letter to ask that ABASA host this lecture here, and the history and the significance of bringing Prof home, the response was without hesitation. And to your team that made sure that even though we were sitting at head office in ABASA, in Joburg, there was somebody to make sure, people were making sure that this happens. We really do appreciate it. And well done to Forte. You have literally made sure that this vision does come to life for us. Thank you very much. I want to recognize my national leadership that is also here. and also some stalwarts that are here, the founding exco of the Eastern Cape. I want to recognize them particularly because it's not always happy times. This province is the one that needs to be revived. So bringing this lecture is not only to just have a speech and talk about prof or talk about CAs or whatever the case may be. We need leadership in the Eastern Cape. And I know from my time, and I'm being the product of the Eastern Cape, we have the potential to raise that leadership and this province to still produce excellence. So I'm making a call, a clarion call, to the leaders in this room. I was even talking to the SAPRO team, as young as they are, and I said, you also play a role. You're young people. I was also young. I was a student leader here. But we all play a role in the ecosystem of making sure that the legacies of prof are fulfilled. Dr. Zaguza, I also want to say something about you before I close. Seeing you walk in the door when we were upstairs warmed my heart. Because when we read the history of ABASA, your name comes up. When we read how ABASA has contributed towards the accreditation of the Nkuhlu Department of Accounting, your name comes up. When we read the contribution towards lecturers, towards this department, your name comes up. So we thank you. And we know that there are many more that are here that are going to continue this legacy and make sure that we do not drop the ball, Prof. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Madam Press. Ladies and gentlemen, President of ABASA, Ms. Linda Maqoma, one more time. One of my favorite sayings is that you should go laugh in the places that you've cried. And as the president, you know, she posted something and said, you know, I remember this hall very well. I don't know what memories you have, President. But I'm glad today you are laughing. And to all the students that are here today, again, I don't know what you are going through right now, Prof. But I hope that one day soon you will come and laugh at this very spot. Thank you so much, Madam President. Ladies and gentlemen, we are about to get into the lecture. I would like to introduce our speaker for today. He is the Chief Executive Officer of SNG Grant Thornton, and he is a past president of ABASA. If we could stand and welcome Mr. Victor Sekese. Please give him some energy. He told me he's feeling nervous.
Thank you, Program Director, for welcoming me. I'm overwhelmed with emotion this afternoon for a number of reasons, which I hope they'll be come to clear in due course. Professor Nkuhlu, Mam Nkuhlu, the Vice Chancellor of University of Fort Hare, the leadership of University of Fort Hare, the President of ABASA, the leadership of ABASA, the CEO of SAICA, the DAG, the CEO of KPMG, the leaders from SAIPA, ACCA, dignitaries, students, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I do not have words to express my gratitude for being offered this opportunity to deliver the address this afternoon. I'm honored and privileged. I'm especially thrilled that this address is taking place in the Eastern Cape province, the cradle of African black accountants. It is taking place at an iconic institution, the University of Fort Hare. The University of Fort Hare is respected worldwide by VC for producing many prolific leaders that went out to impact not only people in South Africa, but to impact people in the continent and impact people worldwide. This is indeed an iconic institution, University of Fort Hare. I'm therefore approaching this address this afternoon from a disposition of being an African. So my address would be as an African. I may break some protocol, MC, but pardon me. The occasion of the 5th annual Professor Nkuhlu lecture is symbolic in many ways. It is my sincere wish and prayer that this occasion will serve to inspire all of us to recommit to the cause and to recommit to the purpose that Professor Nkuhlu stands for. A special acknowledgement goes to you, Prof. Thank you very much for all that you have done for the profession and for all that you are continuing to do, not only for the accounting profession, but for society at large. We recognize and acknowledge your continued commitment to better the lives of our people. We acknowledge you as our father. You are our father in the accounting fraternity. I can safely say that you birthed many black accountants that went out to birth other accountants. I'm not diminishing your impact, Prof, as you have touched many lives from different races and creed. But your impact on black accountants is especially remarkable, bearing in mind our history as a country. Today, Tata, you can stand proud that you have, and the CEO of SAICA came here to dish out some statistics. So I've summed up the stats that the CEO of SAICA dished out. I counted more than around 20,000 black chartered accountants, circa. As your descendants, these 20,000 accountants are your descendants, Tata. But that's not the total population of the descendants of Tata. Because Tata's outlook is broad. It's broad. It extends even beyond South Africa. In terms of the work that Tata has done, he has impacted on Africa as a continent. So therefore, to really count the number of descendants, I don't think we'll come with an accurate number. But suffice to say, it's a very, very large number. Because of the work that you've done, the inspiration you've provided, you have descendants in the likes of SAIPA, you have descendants who are members of ACCA, SEMA, and also you went out and gave to BMF. And you've got leaders who are out there in corporate South Africa, not only in corporate South Africa, but in corporate worldwide, who can claim to be your products, who can claim to be your descendants' data. Yes, we know we are not there yet, but the ground is set. Program Director, allow me to deviate a bit. Allow me to take some time to pay tribute to our father. Prof, you are a very special father. You are a model father. As a father, you are caring. You have a sincere, very sincere interest in development of our people. your interest is not limited to accountants, but goes to society at large. Your sacrifices and selfless commitment to the nation of South Africa does not go unnoticed. You do not only speak of commitment, Tata, but you live commitment. You live commitment in all its respect. You also show commitment in your substance. And when I talk substance, I mean personal substance of significant magnitude. You are indeed an embodiment of commitment. I remember, Prof, the conversation we had must have been around 2016 at a social function. I think Mam Kuhlu was there as well, and we were chatting generally. I was interested in your journey, the next journey of your profession, and you were sharing with me your plans, the plans of the next chapter of your professional journey. You were going to slow down. And Mam Kuhlu was very excited about the prospects of slowing down. I remember that conversation very well. And you were going to resign from most of the boards you were sitting on. And you said to me, you are going to take it easy and focus on your passion of farming. You are also going, this intrigued me, ladies and gentlemen, you are going to take on a journey of an intensive revision of IFRS. You're going to study IFRS from first chapter up to the last chapter. What version of slowing down is this? Really? IFRS? That's Prof for you. That's his version of slowing down. Two years down the line, around 2018, not very long after our conversation, I learned that you've taken chairmanship of KPMG. Slowing down? Now, at this stage, everybody's running for cover. Prof is coming up. Wow. And I said, my initial reaction was, Prof does not need this. Surely there must be somebody else that can do this. Prof deserves peace that comes with retirement. Prof has already done more than enough. That was my initial reaction. Many of us understood, Prof, the move you took. It, however, became clearer in due course that the move was not about KPMG. The move was about the profession, and that you showed how much you love the profession. It was about saving the soul of the accounting profession. Your selfless self came up again, and results are here for all to see. You have really worked very hard to really bring those results, and we are inspired as a result of that. We are called as professionals, and it is expected of all of us as professionals not to be armchair critics, but we are called to arise and be the solution the society needs as professionals, as intellectuals, as black middle class. The society has got challenges and it needs answers, and the answers are sitting in this room. But you arose, Prof. You did exactly that, risking a lot at stake, Your commitment and the love for the profession was once more demonstrated. Prof, you went further, well below our expectations. You proceeded to pen down your reflections and the lessons from your lived experience as the chairman of KPMG. Yet another courageous step. I read that book in 2 days. You were brave, Prof. But that was expected of you as a teacher. You ensured that you pen down so that we can learn and make sure that we don't repeat the mistakes. And you gave us guidance as to how to rectify those mistakes that we've made. And you gave us a framework, tools of how to save the soul of the profession, to restore the stature and the dignity of the profession. If all of us professionals, intellectuals, can commit to the cause of restoration and revival, not only of the profession, but the renewal of our country as well, that will arguably be the highest honor to the legacy of Professor Nkuhlu. I need to admit that the release of your book, Enabler of Victim, KPMG SA and State Capture, was timely. Was timely because of what we were going through, and we really needed answers out there. You providing some of the answers that are there. But it was timely personally for me as well, because the book was released and was published on the eve of my deadline. As somebody was talking about exams and et cetera, I had a deadline. My final thesis submission was due, I think literally in 3 days. And I had it all sort of worked out and it was typed out. I had to revise that 2 days, scratch out reference. So to that, I thank you very much. And I really referenced it significantly from your book. Thank you again, Professor, for coming to the rescue of the profession. We salute you, Professor Lumkile Wiseman Nkuhlu. We say, Enkosi Tata. Enkosi Tata. Now, I don't want to break the decorum of this function. And yes, I'm not gifted in singing. But if I was gifted in singing, this would be the moment where I'll rise up with a song and say, Wiseman Nkuhlu, Wiseman Nkuhlu, hauna o tshwana le yena. Wiseman Nkuhlu, Wiseman Nkuhlu, hauna o tshwana le yena. I thought the choir was going to help me, but that's fine. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Wiseman Nkuhlu, Wiseman Nkuhlu, there's none like you. You are one of the kind. You are a personification of leadership excellence. The title of my address, MC, is premised on the 3-year strategy of ABASA. Driving leadership excellence through inclusive social accountability. This is a very expansive topic. It will therefore not be practical for me to address the topic holistically. My focus will be on the elements of leadership excellence. I'll firstly provide a high-level, a conceptual background on the concept of excellence and how it relates to the phenomenon of leadership. I'll do a brief contextual analysis, which will be followed by a call to action. What is excellence? Tura and his colleagues note that excellence is mostly used as desired outcome. They contend that excellent is a widely used term whose meaning is normatively assumed and thus intuitively referenced. Amongst the many definitions, Edgman defines excellence as, I quote, "the overall way of working that results in balanced stakeholder satisfaction, so increasing the probability of long-term success as an organization," close quote. Tura and his colleagues, in their extensive study of the concept of excellence, they note that there are as many models of excellence as there are definitions. These models, however, share some common principles. One of those principles is that the process of excellence involves inputs and outputs. These are mirrored as enablers and results. Cronin and his colleagues equate excellence to effectiveness. They proposed various paradigms through which the concept of excellence can be examined. The first one is goal attainment paradigm. With this paradigm, organizations are regarded effective if they meet their goals. So excellence is linked to effectiveness. Organizations are regarded effective if they meet their goals. The second paradigm is what they call systems approach. The systems approach, Chair, recognizes the importance of the environment within which the organization operates. It recognizes that there are various stakeholders, various actors in the ecosystem for the organization to meet its goals. And there may be interdependencies amongst these actors. And it recognizes various factors that are relevant to achieve effectiveness and therefore goals of the organization. ABASA, I submit, has adopted a systems approach for its leadership excellence, putting emphasis on strategic partnerships. Partnerships and collaboration with various actors and institutions are important for attainment of transformative objectives of ABASA. ABASA cannot, for instance, VC, do without universities like University of Fort Hare. The interdependencies make it important for ABASA to be interested and be involved to ensure University of Fort Hare is successful. The success of University of Fort Hare is the success of ABASA. Black students, future accountants, are some of the key stakeholders within the broader ecosystems. Human relationships with stakeholders are important in achieving common understanding and synergies among relevant actors. To emphasize the point, Grunig and his colleagues make this statement, I quote, "organizational wealth can be created or destroyed through relationships with stakeholders of all kinds. Close quote. Leadership permeates through all models of excellence. Leadership is a thread that pulls it all together, making sure that excellence is achieved. It's such a pivotal element of achieving excellence. Hence, we talk about leadership excellence. Smishish and his colleagues regard the concept of leadership in a way, that's their own definition, as a process that frames, process that shapes, and a process that defines reality for others. There are many definitions of leadership, but this, for today's address, this resonated with me. A process of framing, shaping, and defining reality for others. Is this framing, is this definition that serves as a basis for action for all the actors involved? Leadership thus provides a point of reference against which a feeling of direction, a feeling of control can emerge that we are being led, my president. Hopeless Africa. Hopeless Africa. That's a headline that appeared in an article of the 11th May 2000 edition of The Economics magazine. A very sensational, catchy title, President. The article carried somewhat exaggerated negative narrative and sentiment about the African continent. The article was arguably unfair and a biased account of Africa's socio-economic prospects prevailing at that time. It nevertheless contained some indisputable truths which could not be ignored. The article lamented on various wars within the parts of the continent that were taking place at that time. It lamented on the extent of poverty and disease that prevailed in the continent. It advocated for intervention of multilateral international institutions like the UN peacekeeping force. It advocated that it must be authorized, it must be supported, it must be resourced to be able to deal with the challenges that exist in Africa. But at the same time, it acknowledged the limitations of international intervention in the affairs of Africa. It eventually concluded that ultimately it's up to Africans to change the narrative. The article also portrayed contradictions in the continent. Poverty, riches. This unfortunately continues to be the case today. Abject poverty exists alongside abundant riches simultaneously. Very rich continent, very rich country, and yet the poor are in the majority. Chair, President, that's an error. This is an error, Program Director. It's an error that needs to be corrected. Who's supposed to correct that error? I think the black intellectuals are supposed to rise and correct the error, or at least start correcting the error. In many parts of the continent, even today, riches are misused for many reasons, including sustaining rebels who are causing terror amongst our people. Africa Rising. That's the headline
of the submission that featured in the same magazine, Economist, the edition of December 2011. That's a decade later. A decade later after they released Hopeless Africa. Africa Arising. This article was more balanced than the initial one. It was more balanced, and it acknowledged that Africa at that stage had a real chance to follow in the footsteps of Asia in terms of socioeconomic performance. The article acknowledged the immense economic potential of the continent. The continent had then, if you remember, been recognized as for its stellar conservative annual economic growth in the prior decade. And also the projections then about the future economic growth brought renewed optimism, brought positive anticipation and hope for the future. Hence the title, Africa Rising. Ten of the fastest growing economies were amongst the continent. Ten of the fastest growing economies worldwide, were coming from Africa. And the growth was even surpassing East Asia and Japan. Sadly, South Africa did not feature as part of that good story. In fact, South Africa was singled out, MC, was singled out in the article for being tainted with corruption. And that the country, it mentioned that the country had lost its model status. It served no longer as a standard or a benchmark for other countries to emulate. The observation was made 10 years ago in 2011. Sadly, I think the observation still stands today. The narrative has not changed. South Africa is still being viewed as a corrupt country. The article noted that they identified economic potential in the continent needed to be proactively and intentionally harnessed so that all the potential could be realized and the reality of our people could change. My president, this is where leadership comes in. It will take leadership framing and defining the aspired reality. This framing and defining the aspired reality should serve as a basis of action towards attainment of that desired aspired reality. We are sitting in this room and together with ABASA stakeholders in all its formation have the ability to change the narrative and restore South Africa to its rightful place as an exemplary country in the continent. I submit, Chair, that it will take leadership excellence to achieve that. Onyani, in his book, Roar of the African Lion, laments the laid-back approach of black intellectuals, black in middle class, in matters of national and global importance, like eradication of poverty. He observed that many black people are not committed to changing the status quo of the majority of our people. He continues to contend that instead of pursuing matters of national, global interest, black people are seized with consumerism and instant gratification. In these circumstances, short-termism easily creeps into the psyche of our people, whether consciously or subconsciously. It is this short-termism that breeds intense commercial culture that is prevalent in many organizations, not only in our country, but globally. Professor Nkuhlu, in his book, Enabler of Victim, warns against the danger of intense commercial culture in organization. Although his warning was directed to accounting firms, the warning is relevant to other corporates as well. It doesn't stop there. Intense commercial culture has led to many big ethical challenges. Ladies and gentlemen, let us be reminded that it is this short-termism that led to the 2008 global financial crisis. This is a very dangerous setting. Therefore, we should watch it very carefully, because it has the potential of continually taking us down and taking us south from an ethical perspective. I'll share with you an anecdote just to demonstrate my concept or my thoughts. Years ago, many years ago, I can't even remember when, we still have, because you know you've got, did I say inputs and outputs? Remember, excellence, inputs and outputs. So input is labor, people, they bring input, output services that you get, then you get money in, and you pay for all your resources. So part of making sure that you succeed, you create, and many organizations have, and we should have, even universities have, I trust University of Forte has, an incentive scheme. So you have an incentive scheme to say, these are our goals, remember, this is our reality. So you frame the reality, you frame the desired reality, and those formulate your objectives, to say, these are our objectives. So Mr. Partner, Mr. Director, this is how much I'll pay you for your input in us attaining these goals. But if you meet these goals, or if you exceed these goals, I'll put a little bit extra in there. It's an incentive, right? So we have a well worked out framework which works every time, every year, and people get used to it, to say, no, normally if we do this, and if we do this and achieve our objectives at the end of the financial year, you know, there's something that comes, I get rewarded for the effort that you do that. That works well, especially if the economy is okay and the organization is doing well. But it's business. There are years where you may not do well. And therefore, you may not be able to pay the incentives. Now, I'll stand, Prof. Talk about the commercial culture. Where then you explain to your partners to say, this year, you know, things didn't go well, and therefore, there's nothing comes. Yeah. The stress, that cost. I was wondering, why the stress? Then I thought, maybe let me go deeper into the stress, because it's expected. This is extra. They call it bonus, DAG. It's a bonus, so just extra. So why are you stressed when the bonus is not coming through? Now, to my horror, Prof, I realized that some people model in this bonus into their spending patterns. They go, are the bankers in the room? You know, they go to Mr. Banker. Mr. Banker, every month, you'll see 10 coming every month. But normally in June, there's a big one that comes. There's a big check. Bah! Now, when I'm Mr. Banker, give me enough money, because I know in June, I'll pay you back. Now what happens? June comes. The big check is not coming. And Mr. Banker, he say, you know, now I understood. But then I would say, but guys, you are accountants. You are chartered accountants. You should know better. It's extra. You don't model it in. And now you can understand where the ethical dilemma can creep in, easily creep in, because then you'll start looking for shortcuts to be able to get that big check that comes in. And these are the ethical behavior that Prof wants us. I don't have a timer. You must tell me when is that. That comes in. To do that. Now, I am closing now because the chairman, my president, everybody, they are looking at their watches. So I need to close down. Now, I thought I was alone in this quagmire. So I was traveling with the CEO of one big four firm. I won't mention that in his big car, very luxurious car, huge. Now we're sharing notes, Now, he's stressed. Now, the cause of the stress is the same as my stress. And he said, no. I said, you know, we've got this house, a finance house, that gives partners loans on a very low fee. Now, we're battling because it's not being serviced. You know, when we don't pay these bonuses, it's not being serviced. I'm going to close down that item. I said, oh, no, man. This can't be. We need to be exemplary, you know, and you can rise. What is causing all this? Is it consumerism? And what is it? Live be within your means. I mean, I don't buy to the adage that a mechanic's car is always broken or needs attention. We need to take the lead, and we read every day how indebted our people are. We need to take the lead to teach people to live a purposeful life and make sure that what defines people are the right principles. It's not the size of your car, the size of your office, your designer suits. Because once we move into that terrain, that's a very dangerous terrain, and it's a terrain that is fraught for ethical failures. Let us not be found to be amongst those people that are disinterested in the challenges that our people are facing. As a country, as a continent, and yes, as a global community. Locally, challenges of unemployment, poverty, and inequality are well documented, and they need our urgent response. Let us therefore rise up and frame the reality that we desire for our people. Then we need not only frame the reality that we desire for our people, we need to start acting, President, to attain that reality, not only for this generation, but for the generations to come. When we do that, history will judge us kindly. I thank you.
Yes, yes. Yeah. I love the vroom vroom part. I don't know which one is your favorite part, but the vroom vroom part definitely got to me. Ladies and gentlemen, the University of Fort Hare Choir. There's so many quotables from the lecture. Thank you so much, Ntateskese. Unfortunately, because of load shedding, we kind of need to move a bit swiftly, but I'm going to tweet as much as I can. And if you can also just, you know, share the message and hold it very close to your heart. Ladies and gentlemen, at this point, I would like for everybody to stand up and welcome on stage Prof. Lumkile Wiseman Nkuhlu.
Thank you very much for this afternoon. Thank you very much for taking the time to be here this afternoon. I'm very grateful to all of you. And my wife is here. She's she's a witness in case I do something wrong. I really want to thank the University of Fort Hare, the Vice Chancellor and the Deputy Vice Chancellor for this honor today. Of all the lectures that we've held, this to me is the most What is the one that I have enjoyed most because it's at the University of Fort Hare. Thank you to ABASA, and thank you to SAICA, and I thank the Department of Accounting, the head of department and the staff in the department, and all the students, the leadership, and the sponsors today. Thank you very much for your support. I'm going to be very brief. I'm not a speaker today. I thank our guest speaker. He is Dennis Proud and Victor. He's a great friend. We come a long way together. He has been qualified for a long time. He has been in this profession for a long time. I thank all the speakers for their words. Possibly my message that I want to share with you is very brief. I want to say, don't be intimidated by what you heard today. If you're a student, you're a young person, you're struggling with your light, you want to be a great leader, there's nothing magic. As I was sitting here, I was looking at myself as a young boy, Kala, barefoot, going to school, wondering how this thing came and I find myself here. It intimidates me even now. So when I think about it, I think of all other situations, one that I'm fond of talking about is at Fort Glamorgan, here, this town, when I was here, coming from Lovedale, imprisoned here in 1962-63, having to stand naked in front of young Afrikaner boys every evening. But here I am now. So, don't be intimidated. There's no magic. You know, things can be very simple, actually, provided you are honest and humble. You know, things can be very simple. What a great country with a great people, but we just happen to have bad leadership. We have allowed this bad leadership to persist for a long time. But not all is lost. We have great, great leaders in this room today who are standing firm, leading great institutions, including the University of Fort Hare. Where things really start and really think about this, that's why I say it's very simple indeed. It's a struggle, it's a journey, of course, that every day you are faced with challenges and you have to deal with them. And when you are married, there's one person, of course, who have to stomach all this thing. I have to stomach her own struggles, he has to stomach mine. All damned, yeah. But really, the thing is that it starts at an individual level, searching for the correct principles on which to center your life. This thing starts in various ways. In my case, when I started thinking about myself, it was my mother used to say, Lumkile, whenever I send you, I always trust you. You never loiter around. You come back quickly, whatever. Oh, I started saying, I'm valued. I'm valued, I'm trusted. That's where I began to value trust, being trustworthy. It went on at school when I was told, my aunt, who was a lady teacher, I was staying with her. He used to say, Lumkele, why did you get only 7 of the 10 Psalms correct? I know you can do better than that. You get 100%. He said, no, I will help you. You can get there. That kind of belief in me and saying that, oh, I can achieve excellence as well. You know, those things, I never really realized them, how important they were. But over time, I became very conscious of these correct principles that must guide my life. This thing of acting with integrity on the commitments that I make to myself. If you can get, if it's not a difficult thing to do. If one of the things that you value most is to be trusted and to be trustworthy, when you do things correctly and so on, you're not pleasing anybody. You cannot run away from own conscience. If you center that trustworthiness in your own conscience, you center the fact that you reap what you sow. You are not going to get wonders and be professor and so on if you have not worked for it persistently over many years. It's getting principles like that. Excellence, meaning that in whatever you do, you owe it to yourself that I do it my best. And I'm not trying to just be 50% and pass. When you say to yourself, I've set myself a goal. I'm going to be a lecturer at the University of Fort Hare in 3 years' time. I will be a professor in 6 years' time. What must you do? You must get your master's. You must get your doctorate. You must publish and get there. You know? So those become milestones as to how to get there. Once you have done that, you have set yourself the goals that you want to achieve, where you want to be, then that informs the behaviors and values that will be that are coherent to you achieving that. So the struggle then is when the influences, the stimulus, the things that come your way from friends, from yourself, your own feelings, directing you to do things that will prevent you from achieving that. That struggle. You can be helped by your faith if you're a Christian or a Muslim and so on. But sometimes just by saying, I am Wiseman Lumkile Nkuhlu. I'm in charge of my conscience, and I'm self-aware. I decide what to deal with my feelings, what the influences around me. I'm not going to allow them to overcome. It doesn't mean that you don't fail sometimes. But when you fail, you have to deal with your conscience again, because it's anchored on the right, on the correct principles. That conscience will punish you, and you'll say, I'm not going to fail myself again. So I'm saying this thing is very simple, ladies and gentlemen. If all of us can think this way, to me, this has helped me, has worked a lot for me. I see the noise around me. I see corruption, I see everything. But I can never blame, I don't fully blame the environment around me for my own failings, because that integrity is to myself. So if we can just, as we go through our lives, learning to be professionals, search and educate our consciences to be anchored correctly. And when you fail to live up to those correct principles, you deal with yourself honestly and make sure that you're stronger. It doesn't happen again. So don't be overwhelmed by what I said. But thank you very much for what you have said. I sometimes doubt that you're talking about me. It's just so overwhelming. But as I say, but each time that this happens, wow, it strengthens me. It strengthens me. When I go out again, I say, when I am under pressure from a colleague that I really love, he says something that really justifies corruption or unethical behavior, and because I love this person, I want to be nice to him, I find myself not taking a stand. I punish myself, and then I will find a way of going back and saying, I should not tolerate that, but say it politely in a constructive way that builds the other person. So possibly I just want to leave you with that thought, that don't be intimidated. There's no wonder, there's no magic. But I'm humbled by what I've said. It's a struggle every day. If you struggle and honestly look at yourself, look when you fail and be able to lift yourself up, you can do it. We can build this country one by one, take charge of yourself, correct principles, be your anchor, and get your family, get your children, help them strengthen themselves, your community around you, and finally, those who go into politics possibly will be people who have actually managed to discipline themselves and be anchored on the correct principles. This is where we've lost it, and I'm sure we can rediscover ourselves. What a great people, what a great country with great people, but bad leadership. We can correct that. It's up to us. Thank you.
Prof Nkuhlu, ladies and gentlemen. Do not be intimidated. It is not any form of magic. Ladies and gentlemen, on that note, to give the vote of thanks, please welcome the Deputy VC, Prof Renuka Vital. Prof.
Professor Nkuhlu, I feel so honored, humbled, and grateful that my path has crossed with yours today. In the short time that we've met, I can see why you've built the legacy you have, and we are absolutely honored as the University of Fort Hare to host, together with ABASA, this annual Wiseman Nkuhlu Lecture, and we hope we will do this for many years. So thank you for your presence, thank you for your words, for your interest in the university, and your ongoing engagement with us. It's also my pleasant task to thank ABASA, and especially the president of ABASA. I can see from the kinds of comments that were made today, the enormous leadership and energy and vision you are bringing to this field. And we're very grateful to that leadership and to all the members and the leadership of ABASA. Thank you very much. Because we have to be quick, I'm going to try to summarize my thanks. I want to thank Saika. I know we will have many interactions with them, but today is a different interaction to the CEO and the leadership there, to the Auditor General of South Africa. I want to thank all the accounting firms that are here, and it was just wonderful to hear our guest speaker, Mr. Sekese, talking about, you just reminded me, the person who taught me how to live within your means was my mother. And I can remember being 6 years old, she had opened a bank account, and every Friday I would get a sixpence to go and put it in the account. And I learned to save and to always live within my means. And when you spoke, I think your words of wisdom were so important. And I hope that everyone here has taken them in and taken them on board. I especially want to thank our sponsors, SAPRO in particular, and then all the alumni. So all the people who have been students and staff here before and now. And then I must thank the accounting department. They have really worked very hard. I want to thank all the HODs. It's very nice to see former HODs and current HODs here, and all the staff and students there. I also want to thank VC and our MEC that drive this together with institutional advancement, which supports all these functions. And then also to our choir, who always impress. They always render wonderful, they just change the feel and the atmosphere of any event that we have. And so to all the professional bodies, accounting bodies, and finally, thank you, Program Director, for taking us through this day so admirably. Thank you very much.
We are joining them now. Come on, crowd, we're with you. Come on. Wiseman Nkuhlu. Wiseman Nkuhlu. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. May you have a great day. Can we take the choir to the Wise man in Kusu. Wise man in Kusu. Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our program. Please feel free to take pictures, network, and get to know as many people as you can. There is an announcement, though, before I leave.
Sorry. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a public lecture. We have to follow a protocol. Please could you remain seated while we allow for the academic procession to leave the venue.
All right. Thank you.
Sva?